This video is sponsored by VinFast. The worldwide thirst for electricity is absolutely immense, and with people like me opting to ditch natural gas in favor of heat pumps and driving electric cars, that demand is only going to increase. I talk about solar all the time, but global wind generation is about twice that of solar, according to Our World in Data in 2019. Studies even suggest that offshore wind energy alone could power the entire world. In fact, 80% of the world's wind resources is offshore in deep waters. So why isn't every country building offshore wind farms as fast as they can, and why aren't they everywhere? When you think about wind turbines, you're probably picturing something like this: massive horizontal axis wind turbines, or HAWTs. But a company called Hydro Wind Energy believes that they have a novel solution to the offshore wind problem by using these vertical axis wind turbines with some very interesting properties.
80% of the world's wind resource is available offshore, not onshore. The question is ultimately, how do we harness that and turn it into a usable form of energy? Our approach is that we're using wind solely for mechanical lift.
But before we get into that, let's talk about conventional offshore wind turbines. If we look at offshore wind speed data 70 kilometers off the coast of Rona in Scotland, here's what an hourly average for the entire year looks like. First of all, it should be pretty clear just how variable and intermittent wind speeds really are. But if we average it by season, we can get a little more clarity. Interestingly, the strongest wind speeds come in winter, which is good news because that's when solar energy is at its lowest. And before you think the wind speeds are super constant throughout the day, remember, this is an average. This is the first major issue of offshore wind. It's unpredictable and varies throughout the day. There's no way to increase or decrease production to match what people are actually using, or even know what you can expect hour by hour. Spanish-German wind giant Siemens gamesa is preparing to deploy 60 of its latest generation turbines of this variety by 2024. Each of the 60 turbines will produce 14.7 megawatts, which is a world record. They'll feature blades that are 108 meters long, about the size of a football or soccer field, and a rotor diameter of 222 meters, about 45 Tesla Model S's parked bumper to bumper. It's pretty mind-boggling stuff. There are issues, though, as costs increase dramatically as the blade size increases, both in larger molds and cast to create the blades, but also the logistics of larger support towers and anchoring them safely to the seafloor using monopiles. A monopile is a steel cylinder piled into the seafloor by a special hydraulic ram. As these wind turbines continue to grow in size, these monopiles will have to get bigger too to support that massive size and resulting moment of inertia. Now, while there are some floating platforms being worked on, these turbines will largely be limited to about 50 meters sea depths, which will restrict where they can be installed. The second problem with offshore wind turbines is that they aren't really able to harness the entirety of the wind's potential. Large wind turbines like these require about 5 meters per second airspeeds to start spinning, and have to shut down when wind speeds reach about 25 meters per second. Their ideal operating range is around 10 to 15 meters per second, and that's where the gearing, generators, and power electronics are sized to operate. More modern turbines, like the Siemens gamesa 14.7 megawatt turbines, make use of a technology called high wind ride-through, which will help with this, but that's a topic for another day. Speaking of another day, we have a very important message from our sponsor this week, VinFast.
So I first saw the VinFast at the New York Auto Show, and now they're opening up locations all along California. And on July 14th, they'll be opening up these showrooms. So if you're interested in checking out one of the VinFast cars, now is the perfect time to go sit in it and just see how it fits you. See if you have a showroom near where you live, especially here in California. And if you don't, they're gonna be opening up more locations in the next couple of months. For me, the VF9 is the one I want. And the reason is we still have an 8-seater gas SUV, and the VF9 could replace that. It has that third row of seating and is tens of thousands of dollars cheaper than any other EV SUV with a third row you can buy in America. And with our $7 gas prices, it would pay for itself pretty quickly. So if you're interested in checking out VinFast, check out one of their new showrooms that are opening here in California. They've got 6 locations as of July 14th, more to come in the future, and go check it out and see if it fits your family and your lifestyle. Huge thank you to VinFast and you for supporting the show.
Being so massive, these turbines actually affect the laminar flow of air, impacting other turbines downwind in an offshore farm. I had a chance to chat with Mark Spieler at NVIDIA, a company doing amazing things using digital twins, AI, and computer simulation to determine optimal turbine placement.
We are leveraged a lot in the design and build, not only of the wind turbines themselves, but also in identifying the best place for placement once they're out in the field, and then optimizing the wind weight coming off of a turbine, not only for individual optimization of a single turbine, but in a perfect world, how do we optimize the entire wind farm? What we're seeing with the increase in compute capacity is people are now simulating much broader aspects of a wind farmed offshore, and using what we call physics-informed neural networks, we can actually take true physics, create a simulated model. What we do is we take data points that they are able to collect, and we can recreate the physics of the simulation using what's called PINs or physics-informed neural networks. It really allows people to see and visualize and simulate what's going to happen in the real world before they actually start.
According to an article by the American Society of Mechanical Engineers written by Michael Abrams, while horizontal wind turbines can be 50% efficient, turbines downwind can see their outputs decrease by 40%. To avoid the turbulence of a 10 megawatt upwind turbine with a rotor diameter of 150 meters, a downstream turbine would need to be installed 3 kilometers away. And these large distances means production density is lowered. Maintenance times would be higher, not to mention all the cabling and connections between them. So massive conventional turbines operate best in a small range of wind speeds, are costly to install, and require more space. But as they get bigger and bigger, the cost per megawatt produced continues to drop, making them cost competitive in more and more regions throughout the world. But what about those vertical axis turbines, or VAWTs, I mentioned earlier? Well, hydro wind energy has created this, the Ocean Hydro Omni, and it functions in a completely different way than other horizontal or vertical axis wind turbines.
You know, they've existed, but one of the big questions is why haven't they been commercialized? And the reason is ultimately because if we were converting it directly to electrical energy, conventional wind turbines would actually be much better to do that. But if you're doing it the way we're doing it, we're harnessing more of the wind resource right up to 40 meters per second, which is, you know, very close. I mean, it is almost hurricane wind.
While HAWTs have efficiencies of 50%, VAWTs are only around 35 to 40% efficient. This is largely due to the fact that the wind hits both the collection side and the side coming back into the wind, slowing its spin. But unlike HAWTs, VAWTs generate a funnel-like wake, which stretches like a contrail, and the wind is less turbulent after it passes through, meaning they can be installed much closer together. But that's not what makes Hydro Wind Energy's Omni turbine special. Unlike all other wind turbines, the Ocean Hydro Omni doesn't produce electricity directly from the wind. No, instead, it uses the wind to lift a heavy mass. Then, when energy is needed, the weight can be dropped, powering a generator. This has some really interesting benefits. For one, the Omni can operate in a much wider range of wind speeds. Because they don't have delicate electronics and generators attached to the turbines, they can lift the weight faster or slower through a much wider range of wind speeds. Also, unlike traditional wind turbines, the Ocean Hydro Omni can respond to grid need, either storing or releasing energy on demand. If the winds are high and demand is low, they can lift the weights and stand by. When demand rises, they can release the weights at a set speed and create uniform power output.
When we're lifting it, we're absorbing the variability of wind power. If it's connected directly to a generator, that means you have fluctuating power. And our approach is that during the lifting process of lifting that mass by the submerged height, you're absorbing that variability of wind, whether it's 3 meters per second, 5 meters per second, or 6 meters per second. If you ask the grid, they don't really like renewables because it's just fluctuating power coming into the grid that's very difficult to manage. Imagine also that if you have two masses, so as one is being dropped, one is being lifted. And then if you think of an array, that's when it becomes more significant. One would be intermittent. But if you have it, you know, four or five of these, then you can actually give constant power output to the grid. It's on-demand power. Wind and solar cannot provide on-demand power because one of the things that's missing to a future powered by renewables is energy storage.
The energy storage potential of the Ocean Hydro Omni is a function then of the sea depth and the weight of the mass. The mass of the weight, you know what I mean. For this reason, the first pilot plant scheduled for the second half of 2022 will be installed at a depth of 300 meters, far deeper than most traditional wind turbines. The Omni, then, isn't just an offshore wind energy generator. It's also a battery and a smart grid-enabled device. To see just how valuable this could be, let's compare the Omni to a traditional 10 megawatt wind turbine over the course of a day. Using our data for Rona from earlier and factoring average and maximum wind speeds, we can approximate true wind speeds for a day. For the traditional wind turbine, power output will increase with wind speeds until about 15 meters per second. Then from 15 to 25 meters per second, the traditional turbines will change its rotor pitch angle to slow down and maintain a constant output. When wind speeds rise above 25 meters per second, the turbine has to do a safety shutdown to prevent overspeeding and damage to itself. This is what I mean by not harnessing the entirety of the wind potential. Plus, the traditional turbines can't do anything about matching demand. It just produces energy whenever it can based on wind. In comparison, the Ocean Hydro Omni can safely operate in wind speeds between 4 and 40 meters per second, which means the entire day it's able to harness the wind speed to lift the weights. But it can lower them back down in a controlled way throughout the day in cycles. Now, a single Omni probably won't be able to produce as much power as a traditional wind turbine, but because they can be grouped closer together, cost less per turbine, they can still provide similar power output over an entire wind farm. And interestingly, if it was built with the same surface area, they'd actually generate at least 4 times as much energy because of the faster wind speed. But where things really get interesting is when we look at power output as a function of grid demand. Again, the traditional turbine can't do much to vary its output. It's just a function of wind speed. But hydro wind energy's turbines can act as an on-demand device. Build enough Omnis, and it would be possible to meet an entire grid's demand no matter what time of day. A lot of the ideas they've employed aren't new. Vertical axis wind turbines, gravity batteries, but their unique packaging definitely has me excited. But hydro wind energy isn't in the clear just yet. Where are you guys in the development process? Do you have these systems out in the wild, or are they coming online soon?
Well, currently we're technology readiness level 6, which means we've actually built prototype, tested components and subcomponents, integrated a system as well, but onshore. The next step for us is to actually finalize a subscale system and test it in a real offshore environment to move us to technology readiness level 7. And we're going to be deploying that in 750 meter sea depth. So it's not a big rotor that we're going to be using, but it's a system that will kind of validate, in terms of the almost a proof of concept of what we're working on.
The data gathered there will feed back into their engineering design and eventual final production model. They'll need to prove their concept can withstand gale force winds out in the deep ocean, show that their systems can last 20 to 30 years like a conventional wind turbine, and come up with maintenance procedures and intervals to ensure their turbines reach full life. This data will be critical to determine the true levelized cost of electricity. If they can win on their strategy of smaller vertical turbines that can be built closer together in deeper waters with energy storage built in, I think they have a winner on their hands. So are we going to stop seeing bigger and bigger conventional offshore wind turbines? Not at all. In fact, there's more interest in larger conventional wind turbines than ever. But the benefits of the Ocean Hydro Omni will be a new tool in our toolkit, allowing greater renewable energy generation and greater flexibility. Their design will be a grid operator's best friend, able to produce electricity when they need it, regardless of wind speeds. If we're going to move away from stable but dirty forms of energy production like coal and natural gas, we'll need every tool we can get. And if renewable energy's Achilles heel is predictability, on-demand generation like the Omni can provide will be huge not only to produce energy, but lower the need for grid storage. But what do you think? Are you as excited for vertical axis wind turbines with gravity battery storage as I am? What percentage of future offshore wind projects will use this approach? Sound off in the comments below. All right, so that is a look at offshore wind turbines with battery storage built in. Not to be confused with tidal generators, which are underwater. And we have video to that, which we think you'll like here as well. All right, I'm Ricky with TP DaVinci. Thank you so much for watching. We'll catch you next week.